Alrighty, everybody, welcome back to our last lecture. So sad. I'm sure you guys are excited though. You're ready for this semester to be over. Ready for some Christmas break, some Christmas or holiday action, whatever you celebrate. So anyways, today for our last lecture, we're gonna talk about wine pairing. Save the best for last. This is probably the most fun part of the class, but the reason that it's our last lecture is because in order to understand wine pairing, it's really important that you understand the sensory standpoint of wine as well, because you really have to understand the wine itself before you can pair it with something. So, I guess let's just jump into it. How do we pair wine? So, first of all, why do we pair wine with food? Pairing wine with food just makes everything much more amazing. You can do it with any beverage. It doesn't have to be wine, it could be beer or cider, but this enhances the flavor of both the drink and the food that you're eating to create a whole new experience of any meal or snack. So if you've ever watched like Ratatouille, the scene where he like combines the strawberry and the cheese and he's just like, wow, it's just all these flavors, these beautiful flavors, and what an experience. That's really what pairing comes down to. So yes, it ultimately enhances the experience so that it's more enjoyable together than they were independently to start off with. So that's why we do it. And because we love to eat. We love to eat and drink, and making it an experience is just a lot more fun and a lot more enjoyable. So starting a pairing, thinking about pairing, so if you think about pairing food and wine, you have to think about it just like you would put together ingredients in a dish. A lot of people will tell you that you need to think of the wine as an ingredient. So that really comes down to knowing the wine. So taste the wine, see what it tastes like, and identify key flavors and characteristics that the wine has. Is it acidic? Is it sweet, tannic, light, heavy, etc.? Then you'll have to use that knowledge to pair with foods that you already know and love. And I really love this picture here, because it does show you, like, so we don't know exactly what these wines are, but this is a really beautiful transition of pairings, you can tell. So this is a really light, maybe an aromatic, acidic wine. It looks like they're pairing it maybe with some mint leaves or some kind of treat. Then we have another white wine, so they're pairing it with like a pizza with a cream sauce here and like some chicken maybe on it. Then over here, this looks like it might be some kind of roasted chicken with rosemary or some kind of white meat as well with this red wine. And then as we move over, we have some sort of red meat on a crostini, a Mary, maybe some kind of like berry compote on it with this heavier red. So this is actually a very typical progression for tasting and what you'd expect to be paired with this. That's a really good example. So I really like that. There are two different methodologies for food pairing. There is a congruent pairing. So this is something that focuses on amplifying shared flavor compounds. So this is something if you would do if you want to, if you like that compound, right? Like you don't want to pair something that's bitter and bitter because it's just going to amplify that and you're really not going to enjoy that. So when you think about wine, think about what do I like? Do I want to amplify something to express it more? And is there a dish that also has that in it that can help to bring it out? So that has shared flavor compounds that amplify each other. So a really good example of that would be like a creamy pasta. So like shrimp Alfredo, one of my favorite dishes, of course. And then you could pair that with a creamy white wine, like a buttery Chardonnay or some other kind of creamy white wine. On the other hand, there's a contrasting pairing. And this is kind of like opposites balance each other out kind of theory. So these complement each other by showing a balance of opposites or contrasting flavors. So example, you could take a super acidic wine and pair it with a very fatty, greasy food. So this would be if you wanted to do the same dish, so like the shrimp Alfredo, you could pair it with a sparkling wine instead. The sparkling wine is much more acidic and will help cut some of the fat and the heaviness from the dish and kind of balance each other out. So very nice contrasting flavors. Think contrasting, opposite, congruent, the same. Cool. And here we have just kind of a similar thing. A congruent pairing has many shared compounds. So it doesn't have to be the exact same compound. I just use that for an example to make it easy. Sometimes they can just be similar families. So like beef and mushroom. They're both meaty compounds, even though mushroom is a fungus and it's not a meat. But they both contribute to what we already know as umami. So the reason those are a congruent pairing is because they share a lot of similar characteristics from each other, even though they're not the same. So this would be like beef stroganoff, maybe with a Pinot Noir, you know, so something that are both meaty that help enhance each other. But then we have a contrasting pairing, which this is a really good example, lime and coconut. Well, lime is citrus and lime is really bright and acidic, and coconut is definitely more mellow and sometimes can be more floral depending on the type of coconut. So this is something that contrasts each other, but they complement each other very, very well because of that. So these have very few shared compounds, but they help to contrast each other. This is a tasting chart. Whenever you're doing like cooking or any type of wine pairing, totally refer to this chart because there's a genius to this. So these are the 6 primary tastes that most affect food and wine pairings. So we have fat, we have spiciness here, a piquant, not sure exactly how to pronounce that, but spicy. So fat, spiciness, or heat, salt, acid, sweet, and bitter. So these are the components that we're working with here. So if you look at the chart, these smooth blue lines refer to things that work well together. So for example, say you have a dish that's very fatty. Well, what's going to go well with that? Salt, acid, and bitter. That's going to all go well together. And spiciness. And it looks like we also have sweet as well. So they all kind of interact. For bitter, this is different. For bitterness, the only thing that really helps it out is salt, sweet, and fat. So if you look at it that way. Spiciness, we have sweet helps complement spicy, salt, and fat. Again, for something super acidic, salt, fat, and sweet help. But you don't want to mix these three here. So see this triangle, this kind of like squiggly line? Spiciness and acid do not help each other. Acid, bitterness, spiciness, these are three very strong components that do not go well together, that will not help smooth each other out. They will actually, they're discordant. They'll fight against each other. So this applies to wine. This applies to food. You think about like bitterness, combining it with sweet, I always think about Brussels sprouts and how people sometimes bake it with maple syrup or honey. It's because Brussels sprouts are really bitter, and having that sweetness helps tame that bitterness out. So that's something to think about. Looking at wine tasting components, it's extremely important to realize what the major factor is here. So for a red wine, this is for like a dry red wine, it can be mostly bitter sometimes because lots of tannins. Tannins contribute to bitterness, as we learned earlier this year. It has some acid, very little sweetness. And this changes depending on the wine. If this is, you know, like a Pinot Noir, it's not going to be as bitter. It might not be as much acid or much sweet, but it could be fruity. You know, for white, sparkling, and rosé wine, typically that's much more acid forward. Those are much more acidic wines. The sweetness can vary depending on the style of the wine. Again, it goes back to just tasting and knowing the wine that you're pairing with, and very little bitterness typically out of those. For sweet wines, obviously it's going to be a lot sweeter, definitely not as much bitter, and lower acid compared to white, sparkling, and rosé wines, typical ones. So when you look at that, you can refer back to the tasting chart, and it can kind of help you see what needs to be helped with. And that's if you're working with contrasting pairings. So something opposite to it to help balance it out. A balance of opposites is what it comes down to. There are, in general, successful pairings that are work across the board. These are really common pairings and common kind of notes for this. The wine, in general, should be more acidic than the food. This should not be very difficult because wine has a pH of 3.6 or lower, depending if it's red or white. Excuse me. And so you don't want to be pairing really acidic food with this. Not normally a problem, but like pairing wine and soda is not the best unless you're creating like a mixed beverage. In general, the wine should be sweeter than the food. So if you are trying to do sweet wines, ports, it should be sweeter than the food you're pairing with in general. The wine should have the same flavor intensity as the food. So if you're having something really heavy, like a really intense curry, or maybe just a heavier dish, you need to have a heavier wine that can stand up to it. Otherwise, it's just going to be plowed over with the flavors of that dish. So there has to be an equal and opposite intensity there. Red wines in general pair best with bold flavored meats, so red meats. White wines pair best with light intensity meats, so fish or chicken. We're going to talk about this in a slide coming up. Bitter wines are best balanced with fat, so really tannic reds, fatty dishes. It is better to match the wine with the sauce than the meat. That's very important to know. More often than not, white sparkling and rosé wines create contrasting pairings. So those are very acidic, sometimes lighter wines. So you want something maybe fatty, like a white cheese. That will pair with that very well. And also, more often than not, red wines will create congruent pairings. So similar compounds that help enhance each other. All right. Wine should be more acidic than the food. So oftentimes, a high acid wine will go well with something fatty. This is why cheeses are such a popular pairing with wine in general. The more acid the wine has, the more fat that you need to have to counter it. So, for example, I went to a wine dinner where we had a very acidic Petit Verdot, had lots of acid, lots of tannin, and we paired it with a braised pork belly or bacon, which contains salt and fat, and it was a beautiful combination. So that is again, a contrasting pairing. Separate components help to smooth each other out. The wine should be sweeter than the food if you're doing sweet wines. So this is a general statement because some of these things are sweet. So it's one thing is sweet or the other. So for example, if you're dealing with a ruby port, dark chocolate almost always goes really well with port. You see that very, very often. Creme brulee will go really well with it as well. That's more of like a custard thing. So I think that's more of a sweet and fatty component from the creme brulee, from the custard. For a tawny port, caramels go really well with it, and that is a congruent pairing because tawny ports have more of a nutty, caramely flavor due to the extended period of aging that it has developed over time. Those tertiary flavors, it's all coming together from our lectures. So that's why tawny ports pair very well with caramels. For like a white ice wine, you're definitely going to be looking at a New York cheesecake. Very easy, fatty to go with the sweetness. Any type of citrus, like a lemon bar, would go very, very well with it. Any type of like fresh fruit or compote over this cheesecake would go very well. Any type of floral character would also enhance it as well. Okay, the same intensity. This one's pretty straightforward, but in general, lighter wines go with lighter foods. So you think about something, a lighter acidic wine will typically go with white fish and delicate flavors. So for that, I think of kind of sometimes like Vietnamese food, lots of fresh herbs and spices and bean sprouts and all these really light kind of herbal floral characters in this cooking goes really well with a lighter white wine. So similar characteristics there, that would be a congruent pairing. Heavier whites typically go with, white sauces and butter. So you think about heavier whites having oak or going through secondary fermentation. So having those buttery characteristics go well with those kinds of foods. So like more rich seafood would be one, and chicken would also be one. Heavier reds, typically meaty mushroom potato dishes. So in general, wines pair best with similar colored meats. This is kind of the most basic comparison that you see a lot on the internet. And if you actually purchased, I don't have it right next to me, the Wine Folly book that was recommended for this class, there's a whole 2 pages where she has lined out almost all the different styles of wines, and then she has like vegetables, you know, fish, poultry, beef, cured meats, desserts, whatever, etc., paired up with all the different types of wines, and she has a little chart that shows you what will pair well and what does not pair well in general with those wines. So if you are super into learning that and expanding on that, definitely get that book. It's a wonderful Christmas present. It's not extremely expensive. I definitely recommend it. She lays it out very, very well. It's also where we got a lot of information for this lecture today, and I do have that posted right here for you guys. This is her website. Whoops. This is her website link for what we're talking about today. She definitely knows. She knows what she's talking about. So yeah, so lighter whites, fish tacos, white cheeses, lovely. Heavier whites, like a buttery Chardonnay or sometimes a Sauvignon Blanc, would pair with like a lobster with butter. So here's another example of a congruent versus a contrasting pairing. So a buttery Chardonnay, congruent, the butter character brings those two together. Sauvignon Blanc has a little more acid, can be a little more bright, so that can also contrast with the heaviness of the butter in that dish. Rosé wines typically do well with like seared scallops, lighter pastas, goat cheeses, lighter medium reds. You think about light red meats, so pork, salmon, fatty tuna, lean meats in general, and some dark poultry meats. Heavier reds, fatty meats, cured meats. I think the dark poultry goes more, can hit the medium and the heavy as well. It just depends. Bitterness is very difficult. Bitterness is something that most people don't like. So the best way to smooth that out is with fatty and salty foods. And sweetness as well, too. So think back to the Brussels sprouts and honey explanation that I gave earlier. So this is actually why, and I think we've said this before, beer and pretzels are so good together, because bitterness and salt helps cancel each other out. Pairing wine with bitter foods, in general, you'd want a low tannin, right? And that makes sense because tannins contribute to bitterness. So you would need a low tannin wine to pair with bitter food. So that typically, like a Pinot Noir would be very good for that. Whites and rosés in general help a lot with that. Spicy foods are amazing. Oftentimes you think about this, you think about like Asian cuisine or even like barbecue, I guess, if you're really into like some of that spicy stuff. In general, the best way to remember this, and this is how I remember what goes best with spicy food, is like you go into a Chinese restaurant and they offer you plum wine. Plum wine is very, very sweet and it's very fruity. So what pairs well with spicy? Sweet. And it all goes back to this chart, right? So we have sweet, spiciness, sweet, and we have fat, and we have salt. That's what goes best with it. So on the note of what's sweet, rosé wines help a lot, bring a lot of freshness and some particularly fruit-forward character, so helps tone down the heat from that spice. Any wines that are fruity with accents of pepper and other spices also help. You kind of get a double action there. Syrah has been said to be very good with spicy foods. Pardon moi. In addition, fat helps as well. So I know we think about fatty wines. It's kind of hard to think about that. The closest I could get to was a wine that is creamy or buttery in flavor. So that would be a white wine that's gone through secondary fermentation. It'd have to be a heavier white wine to do that. So that would be like a very buttery, heavy California Chardonnay. Salt, we think about salt from wine. There are some wines that actually contain traces of saline in it, or saline flavors, and that would be Albarino and even sparkling wines as well. So that's what would go best with spicy foods. There's a nice little article here as well on that if you're interested in reading more about that. So that's a fun one. Overall, what it comes down to, you have to treat the wine as an ingredient. Again, you have to really understand the wine that you're working with and, you know, make sure you know beforehand exactly how sweet or dry, fruity, earthy, acidic, tannic it is before throwing it into a pairing. But this is, you know, this is the beautiful thing about food. You get to be creative, you get to experiment, you get to combine flavors and dishes and things that typically don't go well together. Like, for example, I just went to Best Friend, a restaurant by, you know, one of my boyfriend and I's favorite chefs. And he just did an amazing job of pairing something that was very unconventional with something very traditional. So he has a Korean and Mexican background, and he created a dish that was a fusion that was kimchi and carbonara. And it was genius because the kimchi is very, can be salty and acidic, and carbonara is very fatty. So putting that together, very non-traditional, but flavor-wise, the formula worked, and it was a very good dish. So think about that. You know, don't be afraid to try something out of the box, and you might really enjoy it. So yeah, that's the beauty of pairing. Anyways, that is all I have for wine pairing. I sincerely hope that you have some fun with this and try putting some fun stuff together, you know, at home. Feel free to reach out to me and tell me if anything worked out that was, you know, wasn't sure about. But, yes. If you have any questions, feel free to email me, send me a message to Canvas or whatever. I will be posting a quiz on this lecture, probably tomorrow, Wednesday, and then I will be posting a final exam, at some point, probably closer to this weekend. Our last day of class is December 16th, so please make sure you have it finished by then so I can submit my grades on time, and otherwise, it's been a joy to have you guys. I am sincerely sorry we couldn't have this class in person, but you guys did an awesome job. I really hope that you guys were able to take away some really cool things from this class, or hopefully you found something really interesting and you felt like you learned. But as always, if you have any questions or concerns, or if you feel like something could have been better, please reach out to me. I am super open to suggestions or even criticism. I am a new teacher, so I'm trying to learn everything I can. Anyways, yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed. And I'll be seeing you guys around.